Hello, my name is Jennifer. I've been an ed activist since 2015. I'm responsible for a local branch of ed based in the eastern suburb of Paris. And this presentation is about my experience working with a public of Nigerian female sex workers in that specific location. My team and I have been working with this population since 2014. We have built rapport with this community by taking into account their needs and included them in the construction of this outreach program I will talk about. So I'm working for the association ED, which is a member of Coalition Plus, and our work is based on five leading principles, which are self-empowerment, community-led approach, global health perspective, encourage direct participation, and social transformation. As an introduction, let's talk about the legal situation of sex work in France and how ED is fighting with the community we are working with. At the time we began working with this public in 2014, a complicated law criminalizing passive soliciting was still being enforced. So as you can imagine, establishing trust and rapport with the community was not exactly easy. It took time to be clearly identified and to better understand the needs of this community. Later, in 2016, the law of passive soliciting was reappealed in favor of penalizing directly the clients of sex workers. Officially, this was supposed to reverse the penal charge in favor of sex workers, but most community and health associations had warned the law would seriously endanger the very one it was supposed to protect. And indeed, this contributed in making the situation of sex workers even more precarious by reducing the number of clients. A study conducted by Doctor of the Words, and to which ED was associated, showed that this law had devastating consequences on sex workers, especially those working the streets. They would have to hide and be as invisible as possible, making them harder to reach for social and medical workers. Having fewer clients also make them accept things they would normally refuse, like lower rates, risky situations, and sex without condoms, for example. This study was instrumental in the procedure that a number of community and health associations, as well as sex workers themselves, launched with the Constitutional Council in France. We questioned the constitutionality of the law. But after months of advocacy and mobilization, the disappointing but unsurprising verdict came out in favor of the law. But this is not the end of the fight. As we speak, several sex workers have decided to take this case to the European Court of Human Rights. Our outreach work takes place in a forest in the southeast of Paris named Le Bois de Vincennes. It is a well-known place of MSM cruising because of its numerous paths and dark alleys. And this is why originally ED went there to work with our MSM public. In 2014, as they were finishing the action with MSM, our militants noticed by going back to the larger street that there were dozens of Nigerian women sex workers arriving by bus or with their own trucks. So we met them doing our usual work, distributing condom and conducting sexual health interviews. At this time, we saw that they were totally left behind in terms of access to sexual health care. When we talked about HIV rapid testing, the women quickly showed interest, so the team decided to devote an entire action to them from 2015 onwards. We decided to call it Action Ladies, not wanting to name our public solely by a generic acronym TDS, which is short for sex work in French. There were other associations that worked at Bois de Vincennes with these women, but with very different approaches to our own. Some of them took an abolitionist anti-prostitution stance, insisting they stop doing sex work, which we know did not suit to the majority of women on site. At the beginning, we went there about 3 or 4 times a year and offered harm reduction, supplies, rapid testing, and sexual health interviews. In the meantime, we also developed partnership with Les Amis du Bus des Femmes, a community association, and with the local sexual health center, with whom we began doing outreach works. Recently, our offer on this action has evolved according to the needs expressed by the ladies. It was very cold in Le Bois de Vincennes, and having a place to sit with a hot beverage encouraged discussions about their lives and health. Thanks to this longer exchange, we were able to learn more about them. They were encountered a lot of problems, and not all of them were related to sexual health. For example, a lot of ladies wanted to learn French, and the question of violence was often discussed, be it from the police or from bad clients, as they call them. In order to promote sexual health, which is indissociable for global health, we have addressed this need by developing partnership with different structures, providing specific services, always in perspective of self-empowerment. When we began this action, we met about with 100 women each night. But in 2018, there were multiple forceful police interventions that drastically reduced the number of women we saw. They were obviously looking for undocumented persons they could arrest, detain, and deport. This understandably scared a number of the sex workers away, and there are now about 50 of them at each of our actions. During the years 2015-2016, we found 3 HIV-positive testes, and only 2 in the 3 years since. This could be the result of a better sexual health offer on site, but could also be explained by the lesser number of women present. In 2017, we did outreach work with the local sex health center. On one of our joint outings, they discovered 6 out of the 14 tests were positive for bacteria STI. This confirmed the dire need for a better access to sexual health commodities and led us to begin a weekly accompaniment directly to the center. We can consider this as a real success, as many of them had previously had trouble identifying places and structures that could be useful and reliable resources for them. This link to the hospital also granted them an easier access to all the health offered there. We also had a feedback from the doctor there that told us that not only the women we saw at Le Bois de Vincennes were now coming with their companion, there are no other Nigerian women coming to the sex health center without meeting us, thanks to the community relay. PrEP was authorized in France in January 2016, and we quickly saw it as an amazing opportunity for better sexual health monitoring. It meant getting tested every 3 months, regularly meeting with a doctor to talk about sexual and global health. It could also be a way to access social rights. 3 years later, 13 women have initiated a PrEP protocol through our action. Unfortunately, as we speak, only 2 of them have remained in a PrEP protocol, and this can be explained by the many obstacles they encountered. As an example of the limit to accessing PrEP, one of the first PrEP accompaniments I had with a female Nigerian sex worker in the local hospital shed light on the institutional barriers that these women face because of their migrant status and precarious living situation, especially if they don't speak French. This woman encountered internal dissent regarding the cost of PrEP. The social service refused to include it in a temporary social security program called the PASS, not to mention the fact that none of the social workers we met that day spoke any English. It was a terrible scene. The woman was totally excluded from the conversation about her, since it was held in French, a language that she did not speak nor understand. There was a clear idea that the hospital was not going to spend money on a treatment they consider expendable in a completely arbitrary way. I alerted the doctor with whom we had developed partnership, and she finally convinced them to grant the woman access to PrEP through this program. Later, she managed to secure with the hospital direction a systematic pass circuit for any person interested in initiating a PrEP protocol. As for the woman I was with that day, I saw her again the following week when we returned to the social service of the hospital, but she did not pursue her own protocol. Most institutions and medical or administrative are still not adaptable for non-French speakers in France. Another point is that many of the women we meet are not in regular situations. And the hostile legislative context regarding immigration in France scares them away from institution and association. The omnipresence of police pressure and the fear it creates make it very difficult to meet the ladies regularly. These acts of harassment are often highlighted by community associations who also work with local law enforcement to promote a fairer and more respectful way of treating sex workers. But abuse from the police remain an important problematic. Also, the difficulties where the woman can get PrEP, the facilities where the woman can get PrEP are often far from the places where they live. And taking public transportation can be very complicated. Not only it is difficult to make their way through the Parisian network of transportation, it is also expensive, and it exposes them to a potential police check. Their precarious housing situation can force them to move very often, making it difficult to follow up on a medical appointment. There are other limits that we can talk about. In most administrative and medical institutions, employees lack sensitivity training or often consider these women as victims, thus robbing them their agency, which is contrary to the self-empowerment approach that we seek to implement with this public. As you can see, the difficulties are numerous, and most of them are not related to this public's very are related to this public's very precarious social situations. These women are still being discriminated against because of their administrative situation, gender, nationality, skin color, and the exercise of sex work, including in health facilities. The association and NGOs cannot possibly address all these issues and obstacles without real involvement of the institutions. In the long run, the sustainability of this project requires its integration in public health policies and adequate resource allocation. As the facilities we work with as safe places to welcome this public are already saturated, making the delays for appointment longer. And we know that this increases the risk of losing contact with women who were initially interested in starting PrEP. What our action reveals is the effectiveness of the direct-to-the-public approach. A good example is the recent partnership we are conducting with ADSF, an association that offers gynecological consultations and pap smears in addition to our HIV screenings. This repeated contact allows women to have gynecological monitoring and immediate care when a problem is detected. We could follow this model of mobile consultation to allow PrEP access directly at the Bois de Vincennes, where inclusion and follow-up will be easier for them. Our experience working with the ladies has shown the crucial importance of a trusting relation between public and care providers in order to guarantee adherence to the prevention programs we offer. This could easily be improved by training programs for social and medical workers in health and in administrative facilities. We can also consider developing an offer of legal and service and social service advice on a regular basis. This would allow this public to better know their rights in order to be able to defend themselves in situations of abuse and of violence that they may encounter, but also to access public health insurance. One of our ongoing goals is to train ladies to become peer mobilizers in the association. This way, they could act as educators, advocates, and supporters for women of their communities around PrEP and sexual health issues, as either volunteers or employers. We could also engage them on the political field, participating in demonstrations and expressing their opinion about laws that marginalize and endanger them. This action, ladies, was created to target a key population of the HIV epidemic, one we knew was far removed from the most medical and administrative structures. Working with them, we discovered huge needs regarding sexual health, but they were not possible to separate them from other global health issues. To address the problem brought to us by these women, we developed partnerships with other associations and facilities providing complementary services, STI screening, gynecological monitoring, French lessons, or legal advice, for example. Communities and associations are working together, but the obstacles the ladies face to access PrEP highlight profound structural failure to take into consideration the most marginalized groups that find themselves at the intersection of several institutional discriminations. From where we are now as activists in the fight against HIV, we are very pleased that Paris is finally joining London, San Francisco, Brisbane, and all the other cities that have managed to invert the HIV curve. And we know that PrEP has played an instrumental role in this change. However, the example of this Nigerian woman showed that our institutions are not yet capable of addressing the problematic of the most marginalized populations, which is a major obstacle for accessing PrEP. The multiple discrimination and administrative difficulties they face must be addressed and their needs taken into consideration if we hope to make this tool really accessible to them. And it's not just about PrEP, it's about human rights, it's about the immigration legislations, it's about the sex work stigma, it's about institutional discriminations. These are the matters we need to tackle if we want to end the HIV epidemic. Thank you very much.